Good morning, stoners, and how are my sleepy heads? I'm going to come to you as am. Just woke up, rubbed my eyes, looked at the internet a little bit, got a little stoned, made myself some tea and a bagel, and now I'm going to talk to you because it's just getting so much more exciting and interesting and close to home, very close to home. Okay. So, welcome to Wake and Bake News, and I'm your host, Shampoo VTA Kelly Davis, who is just, I'm serious, feeling great. Very happy. Very happy. I got some new stuff. This is Blue Monster Crumble now from Smart Meds. Boom, boom. And started trying to buy a little bigger quantities to lower the price. Because, isolated. But still, amazing that I'm able to get deliveries. I thought that would be stopped since that's banned here in Ventura. Maybe it's just if you wanted to start a delivery service and grow marijuana and make some money, they're banning it. I don't know. So we'll do a little bit of this and I'll talk to you. Okay, so that I every morning now I'm getting up because I know, just like in any, like the Civil War or something like that, this is a valley you could go out and eat and have a picnic and kind of watch because it's something that's so close to home and part of your community. So over the years I've been sort of passively watching what's going on sometimes because I was an employee and just happened to have a vantage point. It was like giving me a front row seat to the drug war every morning. Okay. It's literally a front row seat. Literally a front row seat. Even though it was guarding the hallway in the restroom, where do you think all the drugs are done? In the classroom? It was literally a front row seat to the drug war. And still a get. I don't have to hardly look out my window or drive down the street or go a block from my house to watch how the story is unfolding here in California. Let me give you an example. So we go shopping down the hill from us yesterday at Big Lots, and I need more shampoo and conditioner. And I'm looking in the aisles, and what does my husband pick up? He picks up these products. Hemp. Those are definitely marijuana leaves, kids. Marijuana leaves in a store where children's eyes might see them. Hemp seed infused body lotion. $4. $4. And hydrating conditioner. Hemp hydrating conditioner. $4 on sale. Right? Because it's in Big Lots, so it's cheap. Measurable difference. Hydrating conditioner fortified with hemp seed oil. I would say that's marijuana advertisement right there. And that's what you can expect from California, the land of Cal Worthington and his dog Spot. If Canada thinks that Ventura and California and LA and San Francisco and all these places are not going to have advertisements with images on them, you're smoking really poor weed up there. Wake up. If it becomes a market and you have limits on your market, we will eat you like you were children and we were a wolf. Like you were made of freaking gingerbread. You better rethink that advertisement rule because that is el dumbo dumbo. And we will beat you hands down in a new market if you're going to tie one hand behind your back like an idiot. Here again, we went and got some more of this Ready Pack hemp Caesar salad kit. See? Marijuana leaves. Now, what I'm hoping for is one day they start putting like marijuana leaves in these or make me. Look at that. I just. That is my fucking. It's like. Like, you know, like this advertisement is supposed to make you feel like that's health. You know? I've never thought I'd hold something in the, like this in my hand. When I was like 16, 17, 21, I never thought I would ever hold something like this in my hand. Especially in a town like Ventura. The seat of conservative dipwads. Okay? It's like, wow, I gotta put this back. Now I'm gonna tell you quite frankly that hemp has been legal to possess in Ventura in California for a long period of time. I remember when you could find a great deal of hemp twine and stuff like that for projects or macrame or something all over town because it became available because it was being shipped in from other countries, but that's really the point. That hemp seed is not produced in the United States. It's shipped in from outside of the country because it's not allowed to be produced in the United States. And so who knows how much hemp seed it actually has in it or whatevs or what conditions that hemp seed was grown under because we don't have regulation over that like we should. And places like Kentucky are not making money off that, or they're just starting to, but they're not, they haven't been making money like they probably should have been the entire time. Once the curtain lifts in the haunted house that all of us have been in for the last 30 years, and you start seeing the devastating mess that this fucking nightmare has created, so somebody could put on a puppet show and get you to believe that this is really important to your life, when in fact, it's just another one of these, you know, it's like every other thing that comes around every other month. It's something new to terrify you, you know, and to get you to, it gets past your defenses when they use your emotions to delight, to amaze, to terrify, they're selling you. The minute you start feeling your heart pound, stop yourself and go, "What? Wait a minute. I don't remember buying a ticket for this ride. Why did I suddenly go from, you know, 0 to 60? Who's hitting the gas pedal?" The minute you start feeling that little snake in the back of your neck cause your hair to stand on end, you know what they say? Like, you got under a guy's skin. The minute you feel that, stop yourself and keep the primitive side of yourself at bay for a moment and think, is this a hook with a worm on it? Because that's how they play you. You have to learn what is going on in your brain and how you react to things and what your triggers are and what your pain points are. So that when people start playing them, you're not like a child, just vulnerable to them and their manipulation. Because you had no idea that you had problems with your father, or that you are a control freak, or that you're actually just afraid of things that are unclean, or something just nutty. And you have translated it into this really complicated view of the world, which really is unnecessary and hindering you from success. In my personal opinion. Okay. So speaking of hindering people from success, I'm so glad to start there. Remember, I'll have some tea because I am a little bit dry in the mouth. I did just wake up. Remember yesterday that I spoke with you about how our city council was questioning this drug task force and property theft task force, which apparently has been combined, which works. I mean, two great things taste great together, right? It's not like it's shit on a shingle here, which I think that's what they did Because how could you possibly take two things, even they're arguing this, and put them into one department and get results? And guess which one's fucking more important? When you put a property crime or someone's identity theft up against stupid drug policies, guess which one is going to fall away? We can, look, how's the song go? The man in the mirror. What can you change? Your behavior. Look, this is what we do in the education system. What can you change, child? What is it in your life, child, that is the same in each situation that you have described to me that is so terrible, that you have suffered so through, that they wronged you in, that this person at work or your parents at home or your teacher at school or that guy across the street or this girl in the classroom? What is it about all of these equations that are exactly the same? You are not guiltless. You are a participant in these activities. Have you never thought that perhaps by altering some of your behaviors, that it might alter the way people react to your behavior? So what I would do would speak to a police officer in the same way. What makes you think that bullying was a good idea? Because come on. You say you don't arrest people for marijuana. Well, you don't allow it in town. You sure as shit don't make people feel welcome. And there are plenty of people scofflawing all over the place with vaporizers, which you cannot do dick to stop. So let's just knock it off now. Because I actually live here, and I don't give a fuck about what the police union across California wants. I know what I want in this town, and that is my right to safely go to a store and purchase things that should be products and not a fucking hassle or a shit show because you think this is important. It never fucking was. Ever. You're Barney Fife with a hatchet wanting to whack, whack, whack the old lady still. The old ladies make damn good moonshine. Give them a fucking cottage industry, motherfucker. But no, you're Barney Fife. Whack, whack, whack! Whack, whack, whack! Nip it in the bud! Grow up. 50s are over. We're gonna do things like in a more adult way, realizing that life is difficult, not everyone is perfect, and we have to make an even playing field for as many as possible. Unless, of course, your agenda is something else, which I believe it is. The whiteness that this town obviously reflects. Our city council. Give me a fucking break. I've lived here. I grew up here. I know what this game's about. You know, you think the people like in Oakview and stuff really appreciate the fact they can't fucking decide who's on the goddamn city council, but they have to put up with the shit? You have problems. And they're big. And the problems in this community are going to get bigger, and it's going to take grown-ups to fix it. And not people that inherited a job from probably really amazing people that helped build this town. Because I'll bet you the people that settled this place had some fucking nards. Unlike some of the people that live here now and want to put foam rubber on goddamn everything around. I'm all about community safety. But what I see as, what you say as community safety, I see as creating a Hooverville over at the corner of Pacific High School, across from the Lowe's and Chipotle, and allowing people to encamp in a supposed shitty-ass skate park that's supposed to pass for some place that kids are supposed to actually become Olympic athletes at skating, And God knows in 5 minutes it'll be a hoverboard they're supposed to learn how to ride. But where the fuck are you on that? We're still throwing a javelin, playing baseball, football. I seen a guy fly over the water faster than a jet ski. I seen a picture of you guys with dogs floating on a boat outside the pier in uniforms that I doubt would help you to swim home if that boat were to sink. What are you thinking? Why are you still wearing those uniforms? That's my first question. Is Dragnet still on the air? I had no idea. Why are you making those guys wear those fucking shitty ass fucking polyester uniforms when you know damn well 5.11 and all these companies make really goddamn nice products and they're wick away and they're odor resistant and water resistant and all this kind of shit. Even the command staff is still wearing heavy leather belts or like 35 pounds or something like that. I mean, they're super heavy. Ask a cop, how's your lower back doing? Does that feel good sitting in that car with that shit press, the bat fucking utility belt pressing up against your lower back and your lumbar and shit? You enjoying that? How's your union handling that? Is your captain care? Dude, come on. How hard was it to figure this puzzle out? I'm just a mom. Look at me. I'm not like anybody. It's just like reading a Sherlock Holmes novel to me. I don't even have to leave my house. Your words, your pictures, your behavior, your stance, your posture, your attitude, your wit, sitting there listening to people and doing a little twitch, it all like communicates volumes to somebody like me. Because when you're standing on a playground and you got to figure out whether or not a kid's having a bad day, you got to be able to do that across a soccer field. Not that I'm like a superhero, but it's simple observation. All right. So yes, yesterday I discussed with you this story about how the city council is unhappy about basically the property crime and all the calls that are coming into the community saying, this is the IRS, and you are going to be in big trouble if you don't call me and give me all of your personal information. Yeah. What the fuck has that got to do with weed, exactly? What, do you think a kid's got some algorithm? He's sitting at home trying to get you to give him his credit, your credit card number when mommy and daddy are at home or something so he can smoke pot? What I need to know what the connections are here so I can start tearing it to pieces, because I couldn't imagine what they are just from this information you're giving me. So you're in a dilemma. Can't give away state secrets because it's national security, right? Makes you look like a big liar, right? So you gotta carry this heavy load, right? Guess where the fail comes up? Should have seen the fact that you need to secure people's trust as part of national security, more than securing your lies or securing some sort of deep, dark secret that you're hiding from everyone. Because whenever people hide things from people for their own good, it turns out not to be so good. Not for anyone. Not for the liar. And not for the public. Kind of the basis for, I don't know, law, isn't it? Not to lie. Not to mislead people, not to obfuscate, not to hide the truth, not to lead out red herrings to try to lead people off the trail or change the subject or answer a question with a question. And how many times have we seen politicians do this? It made us absolutely sick. It's an old sales tactic. You guys are ancient carpetbaggers roaming around in gypsy wagons, trying to sell people with fucking cell phones snake oil. Maybe you hit once in a while, but for the most part, they're just going to come up with a spray, spray you with it, and you'll die like a gnat because you annoy everyone. Someone will make money off of you. one person's disaster is another person's opportunity. Okay. Oh, so what am I getting at? Well, I found out this morning, which I will read to you directly because I'm excited to share it with you. But when I went looking for Ventura marijuana this morning, I stumbled across a story where I did not know that Rohrabacher, who is a Republican, let me say that again, Republican, said that how many women have been raped or people have been murdered by distracting our law enforcement? Rohrabacher asked last week in San Francisco. The Orange County congressman's comments did not sit well with the Ventura Police Chief Ken Corney, our police chief. Once again, see, he's the keystone in this Jenga puzzle because he's the head of the police association and his town is not taking care of business because of distractions and not having funding. Really, it's not having funding. There's not money for these guys. They're asking us for local sales tax, right? In order to fund more police and stuff like that. And I'm like, you know, there's this thing. It's called the golden goose. It's the modern golden goose. And it's called marijuana regulation, MRSA. And if you do that, gold coins will rain from the sky on your head. It'll be bigger than the lottery. You know, it's very much like my father-in-law dying of cancer. We sneak weed to him. We find weed. We sneak it to him so he can bear the pain of prostate cancer. And he refused to take it. After a while, he refused to take water. He was trying to end it more quickly. He was a brave man. Why the fuck should people have to be brave? I will torture myself. That will prove my stoicness. It is unnecessary. It's your way. I couldn't argue with it. But I questioned the necessity because of what he believed to the end. That's a lie that must die because it's as evil as shit. A dude clings to it to his grave. Fuck you. Even if it helped or didn't help, would it have hurt at that point? Would it have hurt to even try? Instead of, no, I will hold these beliefs until the end. What? That's obstinate, mule-headed bullshit. That's my opinion. That's bullshit. What is... Oh, okay. Because of politics. He didn't like the Beatles. He blamed them for drugs in the UK. He thought that they basically corrupted all of the 60s. It was the Beatles' fault. My husband loved the Beatles. Time to heal this kind of crazy shit. Because, I mean, this is like a joke. This isn't Smallville. This isn't fucking, you know, I don't know. This isn't Mayberry. We need to knock it the fuck off and start thinking like modern people solving modern problems with math and intelligence and algorithms and not knee-jerk, hey, how can we take more property from people? Because the same police officers that are saying these things about how, you know, blah, 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 because Ken Carney's going to defend himself here. These same guys, I get a word in first, they were the ones driving fucking a DARE van to our school and showing off a huge van they stole from someone and then put, you know, DARE slaps all over like a clown car and shoved great big audio equipment in, opened the back doors and it had a huge boom box and they could hand out like it was a radio station, like what radio stations do. Don't think that people with an education don't look at that and go, what's going on here? We took this in a drug bust, kids.
so we get to get free stuff from drug dealers. I totally love that.
Yep, free stuff from drug dealers, kids. And we're like,
what?
Okay. So these same police officers, who is a this guy's a 30-year veteran who is now the police chief and president of the California Police Association, who probably was working during the time that DARA was going on, all right? Okay, he said in a letter to Roe and Bacher, Corney said, the statements were misleading and inaccurate, noting that marijuana possession in California has been decriminalized since then-Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger signed Senate Bill 1449. Quote, a police officer that I worked with in the school district, but we can get them on any of the pipes they're carrying because that's $200. It's $200. We at least got them for that. It's $100, so actually, they try to get you on other shit. Okay? The glass pipe is $200. Paraphernalia. Can get them on paraphernalia. Okay? So he's not saying that. And I've heard that from a police officer that I worked with. President of the California Police Chiefs Association said that it's been decriminalized since Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger passed Senate Bill 1449. Considering that the possession of nearly $300 worth of marijuana in California is a non-penal infraction, I am perplexed by the statement, he wrote, which is not an answer. You just stated that it's illegal and let everyone assume that you let it be as the law stands, but the truth is that you trump up charges and you will use it as an introduction to things, to search people's cars, right? Why are the pictures of the drug dogs on a boat, by the way? I wanted to ask this question. Is it because we have panga boats landing between Santa Barbara, Carpinteria, and Ventura off our coastline on occasion? Do you think the drug dogs are going to swim after them and sniff them out or something? They're aqua dogs. Do they have little, like, scuba suits and stuff? I want to know why you're on the boat. Because to me, all I see is hubris. I got a guy, he's a friend of mine. He's got a boat. He'll take us out. We could get these pictures taken. It'll look great on our website. Macho. Macho, stupid-headed, you know what I look at? What is this? San Andreas? Is this like Grand Theft Auto? Are they literally going to chase people in a boat with dogs? Dog sniffing boats. I mean, yeah, maybe that's going on, but I'm just like, what? Aqua dogs. Aqua dogs to the rescue. You know, why not dolphins? Why don't we have police dolphins? Why the dogs? Why do you need the dogs? Why the dogs if you're not busting weed? Dogs don't sniff out oxycodone. Where are the dogs about out in the water? Is it all in panga boats? Because I'm hoping in the future we're going to have a panga boat ride and tourists can come and experience what it was like to sneak weed up from Mexico, like a tour, like a historical tour, you know? Like we go along the fucking mission route where we basically screwed over the Indians that used to live here. And it's a tour. It's like Disneyland. Let's go to all the missions. And let's go see how historically the missionaries basically conned all the Indians into helping them, like, get all the resources out of California. And then when shit hit the fan, they pulled out and left them high and dry. Oh, and they built all these beautiful missions. Why not? We're sick like that. You know, it was like not too long ago, Santa Paula was having this. They have like a historical train ride. They were having a train ride where people were driving along pretending to shoot buffalo. And there was a guy in a 4x dressed in a buffalo costume. And you got to paintball shoot at him, which actually sounded good. But you get to shoot at these effigies of buffalo, something people did in order to starve out the Indians. no historical context. What? I hope you would bother to tell people that they just participated in something to help to massacre the Indians. Did you enjoy that, children? Well, this is what the white men did in order to starve out the primitive people that were here before us. And now they live on reservations quite happily. Quite happily. Yeah, fuck this shit. This is what these people are like. Remember, these people inherited Spanish ranches from rancheros, right? Zorro is based on a character that used to ride up and down in California, right? Joaquin Marietta. And he would steal horses and ride them down to Mexico. All of this fucking hatred goes back way deep, just like any other primitive, stupid backwater fucking place. Because we're wild. This is the Wild West. It always is. It's always going to be. And the drought is going to prove that. That you can build all the houses and put all the palm trees up you want. But it's just cardboard sets in Hollywood. The fact is, it's a desert. And you have to be very tough to live here. So the people here tend to be oaky. Backwoods. And they get themselves into big trouble. Because they get suckered by slicky people. Educated people. You know, and it's happening again. They need to regulate and stop letting people milk them with the sideshow. Stop believing all this ridiculous stuff about car crashes going up and all this ridiculous stuff, because guess what? That's not, something else is going to be the problem, and that's not going to be it. Something else is going to be the problem. Look out for that thing, because even I am. But it ain't going to be all this. Okay, so let me read what our police chief said. Sacramento Bee, May 13th. Police chief says GOP congressman's pot comments offensive. Rep. Dana Roenbacher, Republican, California, left speaker. Uh-oh.
New and better.
Shut up.
The 2017.
Shut up. We don't care about you. Anyway, okay, when Roenbacher, Representative Dana Roenbacher, endorsed the California initiative to legalize recreational marijuana, the one-time speechwriter for former President Ronald Reagan railed against a justice system that spends billions to try to take care of someone who wants to smoke, or try to take care of someone who wants to smoke weed in his backyard. How many women have been raped or people have been murdered by distracting our law enforcement, Roenbacher asked last week in San Francisco. The Orange County congressman's comments didn't sit well with the Ventura Police Chief Ken Corney, president of the California Police Chiefs Association. A leading opponent of pot legalization and probably leading in somehow profiting off of it. I mean, why would you scream so loud if you weren't representing people that clearly are getting... Police associations don't do this shit for free. Unions don't do this shit for free. They're doing it because they're protecting the employees from what? Usually cutbacks. Money. Things like that. Things that, you know, or their work environment. Yet they won't change those stupid, ridiculous uniforms. Come on. You should all be shopping like at Big Five, and you should all be wearing stuff like those guys wear on the golf course. Super light, beautiful, shiny, fucking futuristic. 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 Not Barney Fife. It's like, what? It's like, goes with the 50s cars. What, are you going to skate around and fucking serve me food? Hey, what you want, my hamburger? Want some soap pop? Okay, you know, this ain't the 50s. What the? This town is in love with itself with that shit. You know, people used to actually cruise in this town when I was a kid. Nobody cruises anymore. People used to jaywalk over at Ventura High School. Kids still do, but they're risking their fucking life. There's so many fucking cars down there. Everything has changed. It's like, who am I talking to? Where have you been? Too much this. Too much looking at the tree and not the forest. I see the forest. all my jobs, all my family, what we've been through, I see the forest. Things are changing dramatically. They've always been changing. At one time, my neighborhood in Oakview was filled with people that worked at a refinery owned by Shell on the avenue here in Ventura. Our Halloweens were filled with kids, hundreds of kids in the street, running and screaming and trick-or-treating. And overnight, that disappeared, and those families had to move out because they closed that refinery. It was terrifying to watch. Those families have to leave. My friends. That was like a tiny portion of this. Well, what's happening now is an influx of people with new ideas, and they want a futuristic lifestyle, and I'm sure they feel quite the same, that I'm not sure that watching Barney Fife walk around in a black costume or Darth Vader or any of that shit is going to be appropriate in the future. We want to be able to trust our police, not fear them. And you're scaring the shit out of everybody now. It's too effective. There are conversations between people that I have worked with several years of education in colleges, like, why is that guy with a couple of years of education telling me what to do? Or embarrassing me at work, lording over me, watching me drive away from the parking lot, looking at my car, talking to me about politics, a politics I don't agree with. They're even this other lady who was like a Black Lives protester or something like this at a college got tackled by a cop, and in the dog pile, the lady's like yelling in her ear, "We're trying to help you people. You're the ones that are killing each other. Cal Worthington and his dog Spot. Come on down. We got the greatest prices." You know, it's the same. Like, what, are they going to put tubes in your head now and just feed the advertisements in? Because that's another ad. Except it's under force. You must now listen to my bullshit. I don't know, man. My brain rejects bullshit. I really don't. And I pick it up really fast. And the news is training me to pick it up faster. Off subject. But these guys are selling. They're selling their bullshit. They're selling because they have to. They're selling because they're drowning. Why is this guy? Who is this guy? Look at what he is. You know? Corny said California Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation currently spends $0 annually incarcerating persons found in simple possession of marijuana. Notice that simple. What did I say? But a pipe, that kicks it up. Then they get to look at your car. Then they're shopping. It's shopping. Think of a cop walking through the aisles of a grocery store, except maybe it's your school, and they're looking at the kids in the desk. Do, 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 do. Ooh, there's Johnny. I know his family. They're poor. They're scum. I'll keep an eye on him this morning. Maybe he'll go in my little basket. Do, 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 do. They have access to places that they should not. This police chief, Ken Corny, was asked to go and speak at the Community Memorial Hospital on marijuana and ethics. And he was invited there because the police have an opinion. Now, my husband's reaction to that is there any other part of medicine where a police officer has been like, "We'd like to have your opinion on this heart operation or brain surgery or how much oxycodone we give out"? I bet you they've never been invited to speak on how they feel about breast cancer. But I'll bet you that if they could figure out a way to get in there, they would. Because wouldn't you, huh? If you could, if you had that kind of power, wouldn't you keep trying to push it? My dad told me that they used to come to the water department and they try to get the employees to go looking over people's fences and stuff and report to the police what they see. My dad said, you know what? My employees are going to do their job and I think you should probably do yours. And I would like them to concentrate on taking care of this. I tried to warn the school district when they started coming around talking to principals at our school and security guards and people in charge of security guards. Watch these guys. They want you doing their job. Don't you get it? You won't be doing your job anymore. You'll be doing their job. They get paid for it and you don't. They usurp. That's what dare is. Usurping time to do, and now we're going to stop for this advertisement from your government, which we have no idea if it's true or not, but we're forced to have to say, because if we don't, we can get in big trouble. Because you get to have opinions, but not really. Try walking around in Ventura Unified School District and tell people you got a medical marijuana card and see how quick shade gets shined on your ass. See how quick that happens. See what the union's going to do. I'd love to see what the union's going to do. Now, I know that they've already lost a case. This is hot and heavy. You can feel the dragon's breath in Ventura. Legalization is breathing down their neck. Fire. Fire, 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 fire. I say keep their feet in the fire. If there's any evil, it'll burn away. The good will remain and be a beautiful shining sword, because that's how you temper steel, is with fire. So the dragon should breathe hot fire on these bitches, because what'll come away will be a beautiful thing. But there's obviously a lot of corrosive material here. There's a lot of impurities, and they need to be boiled away. You know, like in a crucible. You know? And then you draw forth like a mighty weapon of justice that is clean. Get it? Metaphor. Writing, art, see? Stuff people should fucking keep in school because it's in goddamn important. Stop cutting that shit. I'm just like totally rambling. Okay. Like concept throwing this morning. Good dabs. All right. I'm just channeling right now. Okay, so he went on to contend that the California legalization measure is not about social justice, criminal justice savings, granting people the freedom to smoke marijuana on their personal property, or protecting public safety. It's all about criminalization and normalization, or commercialization and normalization of marijuana, Corny said. Well, Corny, I gotta see myself over this, because she comes with, oh, this is the Buddhist palm. I'm gonna show you this scene. Buddhist palm. Okay. Okay? And get used to this, because the bottle's going to be made of hemp. The label's going to be made of hemp. You're going to see this kind of advertising all over the place. And there ain't not a one damn thing you're going to be able to do to stop it. And we're going to flip this script, because it's rotten. This is rotten to the core. It is exactly. You are literally talking mission accomplished here. Because you know what? This is like babbledybook or grobbity-grook or whatever. Blah, blah. Because you said current spending is zero for things that are not simple possession, right? So you keep it from being simple. So what is the numbers on that? Cough it up. What are the numbers on not simple possession? And what do you consider to be not simple possession is my next question. He went on to contend that California legalization measure is not about social justice. It is exactly about social justice, you fascist. Whatever this 1984 fucking newspeak shit is, it ain't gonna work. Because I'm part of your quiet little beach community, and I've helped with my family and my husband's family to build this place. And we don't like what you're doing here. And you've been doing it a long time. And soon that we'll, like, have a little bit of say in some things, and we're going to be considering who we support and who we don't. Because we're going to have a business in this community. Because we are part of the community. Like it or not. Like me this way or not. I'm not going to shower because I'm planning, actually. You know, I went to show it off first. And now I'm going to take a shower and try my new products. And make some more hemp lotion to put on my face. Anyway, this guy is seriously talking some fascist shit. And I know that when he speaks it and they're not showing him, he does it in a real John Wayne kind of shifty, you know, like an old football player going to tell you a story, right? And he's got that kind of look, you know, a little bit crew cutty hair, you know, as you could tell what time period he's from and everything looking at him. That's why you're not seeing pictures of him and stuff. So he says that it's about commercialization and normalization of marijuana. Fuck yeah, that's exactly what it's about. Good for you. Give the man a Cupid doll, he wins a prize. It is exactly about making this normalized and getting it out of the fucking black market where you get to fly around like a big black bat and suck blood off. Dumb, criminally minded, uneducated, poor people that you vampire off of like the fucking Dr. Moreau on the island of Dr. Moreau off all those poor people that he went and fucking mutilated. And then you get to be the only one that's normal? Get the fuck out of here with that. I ain't got time for that. We're going to Mars, or has no one told you? I don't know about flying cars, but we're going to Mars. Okay. Reached by phone, Rohenbacher said his comments pertained to the federal criminal justice system, not California, where the initiative would apply. I don't read the word California in my quote exactly, but I think that if you came here and examined what that police officer said, you would find that some of those things are not exactly as he described, or he's hiding some things, okay? Anybody that complains that I am being misled and inaccurate better be accurate in what they are saying, and they are not. Exactly. So the police officer is also playing a little game of twisting. The fact is, we have, as part of the war against weed, or the war against marijuana, we are spending billions of dollars. And it is part of a criminal justice operation at the national level. This is almost like people talking in comments, the way they're fencing. Even California, he said, it's counterproductive. He again questioned how many officers might be distracted from their beats of patrol neighborhoods for real criminals by having to give citations to someone with a joint in their pocket. Rohenbacher also noted that the Police Chief Association was not one of the organizations that originally opposed the SB 1449 city cited in the own in its own letter. I think there's a contradiction there. He concluded, I guess the cops have every right to grandstand on the issue like everybody else does. Now, this is now the third time that I have read our police chief's name in the news, and he's under the finger of God right now. I was just sitting here listening to some music, and I could just imagine him sitting in his office with his little outfit on, behind a desk, getting phone calls, sitting on a couch, having to talk to somebody, those sweaty big hands, shaking other hands, all that manly, hey, good to see you. Oh, yes, this is what we should do, and all this talking that they do and stuff. Oh, I could just imagine. And none of it's going to work. It's all wrong right from the beginning. Okay, so why is it wrong? Because I'm going to show you this video of Gavin Newsom and tell me if you don't think this guy doesn't look like maybe he medicated a little bit. And that's the future. His eyes are the prize. You can't do that. You're a bigot. Right? That's what it's going to be like eating pie. Why were they making fun of that one Republican dude that just dropped out carcinogenic? Because he was always eating. Why is he always eating? Because he has to eat every fucking thing from every state that every local person ever made in their kitchen in order to assimilate to them and try to look human, right? So the dude's gorging himself on their food. What else do they do? They raise a glass. They raise a glass like Hillary Clinton of beer. Or Barack Obama with his beer summit. I wonder, are there pictures of our police officers holding beer? I know that everyone here is very careful not to have photographs of themselves holding beer. But I'm sure there's some event where they've had to assimilate, and they do love to have pictures taken of themselves. So I wonder if you could dig and find that. But I'm sure there is some hypocrisy there that you could discover. He is doing the same thing now. He's telling me, as a stoner, with his close-up and with the way he looks, that he's on my side and he's my kind of politician. And he's the kind of politician I'm going to be looking at in the future. And that may make a lot of people cry, but too fucking bad. Get the Visine, you know? Get the red out, you know? So let's take a look at this.
Mikhail. You name it.
2010 campaign and today is the amount of due diligence that went in this process over the course of the last few years. We convened a blue ribbon task force. We had town halls all up and down the state. The task force was very diverse, people supportive and opposed to legalization. And we helped inform the initiative process. We put out a series of recommendations and we went out to all the folks that were sponsoring an initiative this year. And there was one initiative that took the vast majority of those recommendations to heart and made the amendments, and that's the initiative we support today. And so fundamentally, I think that's the difference. Second difference is the coalition. As a consequence of that outreach, you have a coalition of support that is so much more diverse than it was in 2010. But let me make this final point. Had it not been for 2010, we wouldn't be here today. Had it not been for the proponents of Prop 19, we wouldn't be here today. So they deserve an extraordinary amount of credit for having the courage of their leadership, which was national leadership at the time, before Washington, before Colorado.
What do you think? Is it as American as apple pie? Are the eyes gonna be the prize? I think Prohibition's going to die. I mean, really, seriously. The guy looks a little, was it like a really hay feverish day? Because if it was, he'd have a little bit of a red nose. If your eyes were that itchy and watery, you'd think that some little offling would run and get some Visine for a guy who's about to be on camera. But he looked particularly irritated in the eye area and nowhere else on his face. He wasn't breaking out in a rash. He wasn't sneezing or coughing. And I would have asked him, Gavin, follow my finger. Can you cross your eyes? Can you cross your eyes? Look at me. Come with me to the office. Come with me to the office. No, I'm sorry, Gavin. No, because you look stoned to me, Gavin. It appears that you arrived to school today stoned. Now, we can't come to school this way. We know this, right? We've been told this many times. I know that they told you this in the orientation before you joined our program. If he was a kid in my hallway, he'd be, oh, you're coming with me, kiddo. Okay, so just as there was a beer summit at the White House, I predict that Sacramento will definitely be the capital of ganja if Lieutenant Gavin Newsom becomes Governor Gavin Newsom. Whereas people speculated that there was pot smoking under Jerry Brown's first administration in California, I predict there will definitely be pot smoking, maybe not on public grounds, but certainly by public figures and maybe in public sight. And this kind of explains to me why I didn't see a lot of video or any images coming out from the announcement about getting all of the signatures. I thought that was just slighting people. And now when I see the image, I'm like, oh, they thought maybe he looked a little crusty and red around the eyes too and were upset. It was like that in their face. Hello, it's that in your face. Hello, everyone. This is Kelly coming to you. Shampoo VTA coming to you for Shampoo's new beautiful hydration body wash made with essential hemp oil. Yes, that's right, kids. Prohibition is deader than a doornail. It's so dead, it's on sale. I hope the federal government's looking at that. It's so dead, it's on sale. I'm hitting my hypo spray. That's a good hypo spray, man. That medication was very cleanly and effectively delivered into my system without piercing a hole in me or having to disrupt my digestive system with a fucking pill that it has to goddamn handle because somebody thinks I'm a fucking horse. Okay? Thanks, Dr. McCoy. Thanks for the hypo spray. Also, to recap yesterday, remember that we talked about Stephen D'Angelo and his success. Well, this is now coming out to a lot of people that there appears to be what was described in one story as a federal loophole to block marijuana regulations, right? So I want to go to this one. So this is to recap on Stephen D'Angelo's story. This is out of the San Francisco Gate. It's official. Documents confirm Oakland pot shop's major victory. This is a major fucking victory. All right. So I'll show you this picture of Stephen D'Angelo celebrating outside, I guess, of the courthouse. All right, so I will read this to you now. So, now for my next trick. I'm going to transform myself with these hemp, bathing products and to come out, and you will see that I have not caught fire, or got a disease or a rash or anything from using it. And you will see that this is what basically the future is going to look like, and it's no big deal. And the history books are already laughing at anybody, like our police chief, that's talking this ridiculous old Barney Fife stuff. Nip it in the bud. Nip it in the bud. You know, no. Be more like Disneyland. Enforcement without even people knowing that they're being, maneuvered, and not maneuvered to just milk them, but to keep them safe so they can enjoy the park and spend their money and go home, and you make a hell of a lot of money off of that. You don't suck them in and then try to lift their wallets, All right. Let's go try these products. I'll be right back. So here I am, all cleaned up with these products, and I can give a review of them now, okay? So I washed my hair with, it was actually a different herbal thing, and then I used the, they're heavy. I used the hemp conditioner, which I will admit is not a thick conditioner, being at $4, but they give you a lot of it. But I would definitely say it's coconut oil based, and that made my hair feel really good. I see soybean seed extract. There's a ton of stuff in here. Stuff I can't pronounce. Citrus acid, hemp seed oil. Is probably past cannabis sativa hemp seed oil. Cannabis sativa hemp seed extract. So there's oil, extract, and olea, olive oil, sunflower oil, some other vitamin E oil, sage, nettle, green tea, horsetail, soybean, pro-vitamin B5. So what do you think? Not bad for old hair, okay? And I use the hemp lotion or bath wash. And I even made sure to wash myself so that this touched directly on my skin. And I am a person allergic to plants and stuff and plant material. I'm very allergic to perfume soap. I've had stuff that will literally give me like hives, if it's got really bad perfume. I can't even walk in the aisle for detergents. The fucking reek of those, laundry detergents and stuff makes me sick. And if it's too heavy in my clothes, it will make me sick. I can't breathe. I'll have an asthma attack. It's horrible. So if this was bad for me and I rubbed it near my eyes and everything and all over, then I would be breaking out, right? I'm sweating, but I'd be breaking out, Okay. And then the next thing I did was, take this thing off, it's hot. Johnny Cash. Because Johnny Cash used to live down the hill from where I grew up. He had a house there. He was smart too, the way he picked his house. It was on a hill overlooking a river. So you don't get really bad wind there. It's kind of shaded. You get a view. I could see why I picked it, too. It probably reminded him of where he was from. That's why my family liked it here, too. The place looks like someplace like West Virginia or something where, my family's from. So you just automatically go. And then that probably reminded them of someplace in Scotland, This is like the old country. That's why you keep finding us people here. Okay, so what I did was I made some, it looks gooey, but I made some lotion, hemp lotion. So I just took the leaves and I cooked it, right? Cooked it, heated up it with olive oil, just olive oil. That's it, olive oil, right? And infused the olive oil, right? And then I took that olive oil and added it to just some store-bought, normal, cheapy lotion. Skincare lotion, see? And I put that all over me,
on my face. See, this is my face with lotion that I've been making. Okay. And I use it on my scalp. And I use it a little bit in my hair like an after conditioner. So that it kind of is helping to... So my hair is very gristly now I'm older. So it kind of helps moisturize everything. And it's simple, you know. And I know I'm getting that hemp seed kind of infusion in my hair. So we'll see what that does. But I'm pretty happy with the results. I really like the way it makes my skin feel, you know. And I like that it's the hemp seed oil I'm making, or the hemp oil I'm making, you know, as my plants bud more, will get more and more medicated. So it can be like for sore muscles in my hands and joints from playing guitar and stuff like that. Because stretching out your hand and changing how far your hand can stretch. Let's see. Make sure that's right. Yep. Look at that. It's crazy. I can tell my hand is a little different than the other hand. Yeah. It's weird. I changed my hand. The hand I've had for like 50 years in 2 years gets changed to and it's strong. It's as strong as this hand. And it was never my whole life as strong as this hand. And it's weird. It's so cool to have, you know, this one's like feeling all like, I need to start working out. Yeah. It's so weird to have this hand so strong and then the fingers and stuff. You're and certainly hemp and smoky marijuana and dabs and all of that has been part of that whole year and a half experience of playing rocksmith. I know with my brothers, they say the same thing. They can play longer and they can concentrate on the game longer without, you know, getting tired or feeling pain or fatigue or something using cannabis. Okay. Not very much left in there. So that's it. That's my show for today. I just thought I'd bring you some of this local news because I really do think that this police chief and the fact he's the head of the California Police Association, that's one of the biggest ones that lobby against legalized marijuana, even though he's like, we're not against this. It's interesting that you're talking like that now, because I remember a time when you were saying very different things. So it sounds like you're losing ground. And if now that just whets my appetite, as you know it would, to continue further, because now I realize, ooh, ooh, it's that look you get when you're playing a video game and you know that against all odds, there is a possibility, there's a way to win, there's a way, you know. So I'm glad to share that with you, that I'm having that experience here, even though I'm sure that the city council and these guys are still going to be slow about getting things regulated. As you can see, you're buying, there's more and more hemp products available in this area. And that really has nothing to do with the city council or anybody. And you're talking about a town that at one time ran out a bong store on Main Street back in the 70s. Because the old people in the area complained and didn't like it, you know? That's a big, I mean, it took a while for that change to happen, but that's a big fucking change. You're talking about a town that at one time got pissed off because there was a record store here called Wild Planet, and they put the cover to Nirvana's first album with the baby swimming in the pool with his little wingy-dingy hanging out in their window. And the town council said it was child pornography. And we literally had that argument here in this town. And that's all gone now. And this is going to be gone too. The sooner you catch up with that concept and start being proactive in a positive way, rather than trying to hold the reins of something that's clearly galloping. I mean, what is the guy saying? This is all a grab. This is all trying to just make money. and trying to normalize the market. I mean, it's literally, he's saying exactly what, yes, that's exactly right. Good for you. You figured it out. We're trying to take it out of the shadows of stupidity and bring it into the normal world where everybody else is like normal people instead of, you know, I don't know, this haunted house stuff that you've created, because this is not the way to run a society. This is dystopic nonsense, you know, and it isn't going to work in the age of little brother. Last thing, I appreciate Mudflap's insightfulness in his last video about me. Thank you. I appreciate that. Yeah, it is difficult to meet any sort of, I'm not into the challenges because they get out of hand with some of the other communities. Like the challenge thing is kind of a problem on YouTube right now, you know, because did you see that girl with the corn doing the corn challenge, and she had it in a drill and she's trying to eat this corn with a drill, like, you know, like Charlie Chaplin, and the thing went up her face and grabbed her hair and tore her hair out. And I'm not saying that we're going to do that, but just the whole, ooh. Wow. Just the whole concept of challenges is hard because you can see people are being injured because there are some people are not that bright that are going to do challenges that they should not be engaging in. And I don't know that I can contribute to that. And I don't know we are, but I know it's an issue. So yes, thank you. Very insightful of Mudflap to not challenge me. Thank you. It's not that I'm politically against it. I really don't have the resources to meet these challenges because right now, you know, it's hard to get weed and it's expensive. But the other thing is I have noticed that it's a, wow, when that girl pulled her hair out, I mean, I just went, oh, see, no. Just so you can get a video. Well, you got your 15 minutes, lady, but, okay. No. So, you know, it's kind of like, I'm not saying it's like Gene Simmons needs to stop breathing fire and kiss because little kids are trying it in their garage and catching themselves on fire or something like this. Like back in the 70s or whatever. I'm not trying to be like that. I'm just saying that that was a real case. I did see that girl do that. And I've seen other people harm themselves doing these, not stoner challenges, but like the cinnamon challenge. I saw a girl nearly choke herself to death eating as many cupcakes as she could shove in her mouth. And her friends are doing, she passed out. This was a while ago too. And this guy's giving her CPR and he's like banging her head on the, not CPR, but the choke thing. And he's banging her head on the table. So she's unconscious and turning blue. And I'm like, see, those kids are not maybe smart enough to handle 911 or what you're supposed to do in an emergency situation. And so sometimes the challenges get, they're dumb. There are dumb people out there. And they'll try to do something really dumb to get popular, and I don't want to participate in helping them get injured. So that, I appreciated that. Thank you. My husband saw your video first, and he said, oh, I was out in the garage doing something. He goes, oh, yeah, Mudflap said something, and you should see it. And I was like, oh, that was really nice of him. Thank you. Yeah, it's hard to meet the challenges. And yeah, it is a little, if you've seen some of the things that have gone wrong with these challenges, you go, oh. It's not marijuana. It's this other crazy shit. Pepper challenges. And, you know, and it's like, well, I don't know. Like if I was into food eating contests. Kind of, I would be contributing to people harming themselves physically for a contest. I don't know I could feel good about that because that food really is harming them, unlike marijuana. You've seen people take gigantic dabs, and the only thing I could think of is maybe don't trip and fall on that big, huge hot plate, you know? You know, like you bump your head or something. I mean, I can't imagine what damage would be done by that, but it's perfectly safe. But things like alcohol challenges and shots and stuff, it just goes into that macho thing, and I start going, somebody's gonna get hurt. The mommy in me starts coming out and going, I don't know. I don't know. Used to have girlfriends in school do that monkey bar thing on the playground. And they would challenge each other till my girlfriend broke her arm doing something called a cherry bomb. A backflip. She's this Nadia Comaneci, okay? She's doing this backflip and this thing and land, and she broke the shit out of her arm. And, you know, if you've ever seen those old 1970s monkey bars, it was basically the grass, sand, and metal, and that was your playground, you know. And so, yeah, girls would get hurt doing that stuff, and so the playgrounds had to say, hey, stop doing some of these dangerous and rough games. What's the other? With the one where they hold hands, and then kids try to run through and break through your line of defense, break through your arms, or break your arm, you know. There were just certain things we had to kind of stop on the playground because they were, it wasn't that it was bad, it's just that there were kids getting themselves so worked up doing it that they were finding ways to hurt themselves that we were like, okay, now you guys are just really creative and we can't keep up with that. And I mean, seriously, I could not let a tree branch dangle too low over the playground without immediately harassing somebody to take care of it. Because the kids would suddenly be Tarzan. Oh, you couldn't let a stick fall from a tree on the ground without it suddenly becoming a weapon. You know, they were searching the ground for tools like, like primitive man, you know. So I just know from my experience that you kind of have to not set up circumstances where things are going to kind of whip themselves up out of control. You have to have a way to keep it sort of level. Like, yes, this is a challenge. Not to race to see who will be first to get to the grave. Just a fun challenge. We're not racing each other to our tomb, okay? You know, which is nothing to do with marijuana. I'm just talking about all these other crazy YouTube challenges that look like, good for you. You did that. How many other people are hurting themselves getting that done? Trying to beat you, you know. I guess if you want to do that, but I don't want to encourage that. I don't know if I am. It's a moral dilemma I'm having over the challenges. It's like, ooh, cool, I have a challenge. Good, I'll make a video, and I'll do this. And then I started thinking, and then like that girl with the corn. She's like, I know, I'll meet that challenge. I'll make a video, I'll get some corn, and a drill. This will be great. Jesus Christ. So I don't know. I have a moral dilemma about the challenges. Just some people take the stuff where they're just doing stuff that's not dumb, you know, pouring lighter fluid on themselves and setting themselves on fire and thinking they're like pyrotechnic expert in Hollywood. Next thing, their hair, and they're like, you know what I mean, trying to put it out and makes a funny video, they get lots of hits. That's not the way to get popular, children. That's dangerous. You'd end up looking like Deadpool. You ever play Jump the River? They put out like two jump ropes, like two lines, and they make a river. And it starts out very narrow. And kids jump. Jump, jump, jump. And then they widen it. And kids jump, 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 jump. And then they widen it again. And kids jump, 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 jump. Well, I was one of those last kids trying to jump the widest river at the end. And I realized you could hurt yourself doing this. And people did hurt themselves doing that. And they had to stop it at my school because people were really pushing themselves. There was this girl, she was tall like a crane. Just this beautiful blonde, like a beautiful blonde horse. She was just such a galloping child when she played and stuff, and long-legged and stuff. And she could really jump. you know, across this, but you would almost have to jump beyond your ability to jump, you know. And on a playground full of gopher holes and tree branches and stuff and sporks or whatever, this is not necessarily the safest thing, and the school district cannot afford to have children breaking their legs out there doing that stuff. So we're always challenging ourselves to do these things. And so people just have a natural drive, even me, to excel at something, even something like trying to eat corn with a drill. And I have to stop myself and go, should I really encourage this kind of behavior? I realize the girl is not drilling her head with corn because of me. But in an offhand way, I feel that if I don't draw attention to this issue, then I'm contributing to the problem. It's the best I can come up with. Jesus Christ, I don't want to see any more videos like that anymore. Let's put you that way. Holy shit. Okay. So I really appreciated that from Mudflap. And it gave me a chance to talk about the issue, which I'm kind of embarrassed to talk about because I don't know where I fall on this. Because as like sort of an independent, not that I'm independent conservative, I'm actually quite liberal, but I'm not. I'm more like blue dog, you know. But anyway, looking at it from that point of view, I'm like, I'm not responsible for the dipshit girl with the fucking, you know, she's dumb. This is a lesson to learn, everyone. Don't do that. Okay, don't do that. Look, stupidity, everyone. Stupidity. Yes, you know, but part of me goes, Jesus, God in heaven. I know it's not my fault, but there must be some way that I could help to prevent that sort of tragedy from occurring without parading her bald head before you to see what happened, the horrific outcome, you know. Ugh. Okay, and obviously, at the end of all that talk, I'm going to throw up a little bit of that video at the end, but I'm telling you, not safe for work and not safe for you, and it's cringeworthy. It made everyone in the room turn away from the TV. I mean, when I played it, half of the people sitting here went... So that's a warning to you, okay? So I guess on that note, I'm going to say you stay high and goodbye, and I'll see you on Monday and watch all the wonderful live shows. I can't wait to see Freddie Pritchard's show. And, you know, check out Making Clouds with Mudflap. He has a wonderful channel. So does Tim, right? T-Town Tim, if I'm saying that right. And I've subscribed to some new people. If you look at my subscribers that I found out there that are just older guys that are sharing like vaporizers. Yeah, T-Town Tim, I got it right. You know, I'm remembering your guys' names better than people I fucking worked with for like 20 years. It's weird. I was telling my dad about Mudflap because I went to go see my dad and I was sharing with him some of the stuff that's been going on with us. And I was like, I guess, you know, he's my friend, as much as I guess a friend could be over the internet. But yeah, you get to feel very close to people because you're actually talking to them and disagreeing with them and maybe even kind of peeving them off a little bit sometimes without meaning to. But just like any relationship. So it's like, yeah, this is a person that I'm getting to know and maybe it's like at a party. Oh, you're interesting to talk to. And oh yeah, there's this other guy. You know what? You guys should get together because you have so much in common. And I just want to be involved in that conversation because it interests me, you know? And then you start like walking around like a pod gathering people to you. Come here, come here. You should hear what they're talking about. You'd like this, you know? So that's what I feel like YouTube's really done for me. So check out their shows. And it's not just watching their shows. You become part of their community. You know, you contribute your story. And then suddenly your little light shines in the world. You know, be a light unto the world. You just can't help it. The minute you start talking about your experience in your life, boom, candle starts to turn into a giant blinding light from an astral plane, you know. Because you're talking about real life. You're talking about your real experience. It's not hokum politics, money, somebody selling. It's real. You know, it's really, really real, you know. So that's what I like about YouTube. So definitely go and check out their shows. Some of the other subscribers I've just picked up recently, Of course, I'm going to go to my subscriptions and take a look real quick. I was following the two high guys, and they split up into one high guy and another guy that'll show up occasionally, I guess. They're having struggles, and I kind of feel really bad for them. I do. It's okay, kids. It passes. I swear to God, everything that's happening now, you will look back at and laugh one day. And I know you don't believe that now. But if you are struggling to find, it's, think of it as concrete and your lichen. And you just got to find your niche to grab onto. And once you do, you'll begin to erode the rock and make roots and grow. But you, it's a big, wide world out there. And you've got to find a little tiny crack in the sidewalk that you can grow a beautiful flower out of. Get it? And once you see the world that way, and there's plenty of cracks that people don't see. And once you discover your place, and it may be someplace you didn't even realize it was with me. I certainly wasn't planning to work in the school district. But it became it was the greatest thing I could have done with my life, honestly. Especially out of things I wanted to do. Looking at the things I wanted to do looked childish and stupid. I'm glad that I got pulled by life, you know. So the two high guys will be fine. There's a lot to go through in life. Things are changing now. It's okay. Okay. And this other guy, Gord Birch, right? I caught him doing a vaporizer review, and he seems like another just really cool guy, just doing these videos and talking about his experience as a cannabis patient. And I think that's the kind of voices we need to hear more of. Mark Clokey, I've been following him for quite a while. I just started following Medically Fit. Mary Loves Glass. I've been following her for a while, and I just love her channel. It's a lot about products and stuff like that, and I'm not necessarily big into the vaporizer videos, but you'll always draw me in with glass. I want to see the pretty, pretty glass. But vaporizers are just kind of, oh, another flashlight review. Yeah. I subscribe to a lot of things that are not, you know, marijuana related. Like, for instance, Shug Mary's channel about hiking and doing camping. I just love going along for the trip with him because I can't do that right now. I can't go camping. So I'm virtually camping with Shug Mary, you know, and the Hickory brothers, and sharing their moment, you know, out there. Like, I wish it was in 3D. Man, if this shit gets in 3D, Shug Mary, oh my God. If he's out there, oh my God. And then when you throw the camera, we'll all totally be sick because he likes to throw it in the air and have it slow motion, you know, and I'm like, okay, so Shug Mary's really cool. I also subscribe to the Library of Congress, you know, the History Channel, which has a lot of great stuff. Coral Reefer, who is an activist out of Santa Barbara. But I also follow Rob Chapman, who sells guitars in Britain and has not one damn thing to do with marijuana, because I'm learning about guitars. You know, so there's tons of fabulous stuff to check out on the internet. Jane Drow. Oh, Ray! Yay, Ray C made a new video. I haven't seen him in a while. Fucking Ray, I was like, what's going on, man? I see your picture there in the thumbnail. What up? What up? Where you been? I was worried about you. Stay safe, man. You know? Ray's channel, he was talking about all this. He was fucking planting marijuana seeds in, like, planters around, like, his local town, right? Because he's in Canada. So he was, like, doing this, and then he's planting other plants, like, to feed butterflies or bees or some shit, if I remember correctly. And I'm like, oh, yo, I would never do something like that here, because our environment is so, it's very sensitive. And you don't want to introduce things that, you know, you don't, not that hemp is going to take over the national forest or something, but the shit can grow anywhere. And we already have a big problem with the rondo. But I think in city planters as a protest thing, that's brilliant. I mean, that's brilliant. Could you imagine the Ventura V on the hill surrounded by marijuana plants? Wonder how long it would take for the city to realize that was going on. People would probably be driving by it for days before they went, what is up there, you know? It's a little groove of something. So Ray was also doing some of his own business and stuff, which made me concerned about his safety. But the same thing kind of is happening where in Canada that's happening here, which is that apparently if you're not brown, then you're down, you know. If you're a white person, which that's what you're going to see most of in these videos, in these YouTubers I'm talking about, is that you're safe. But if you're a brown person or poor or homeless or something, you're still under the gun, and that just can't be allowed, right? Okay, so Cannabis Review TV, I've been checking that out. And of course, Sound Experiment, always watching his channel, just to hook you up with some of the stuff. It's Ty Bizarro. That's it. That's what the two high guys turned into, is one high guy named Ty Bizarro. and he's staying with his parents right now. My sympathies. I saw the cross hanging on the wall and I was like, oh boy. No wonder he's doing vlogs at midnight, poor kid. He's dropped out of college a couple of times, so he's still finding his way. I don't blame him for dropping out of college. It's hard to... I watched my boyfriend go to UCSB and he changed his subject a couple of times. You know, he went in there, I'm going to be a chemist. And boy, that college is a wake-up call. You know, you come from your little town where you're a shining star and you come to the big sea of competition and it can be very rough. And it may not be what you expected. It may not be the career that you actually desired. You know, so I could totally understand what he's going through. I've seen a lot of people because my boyfriend, you know, went to UCSB. So for 3 years, I was around a lot of college students and hanging out up there and doing shrooms and smoking pot and talking to rich kids. And I learned a lot about what they were going through in the 80s. And it was real tough. There was a lot of stress on those kids, you know, so I can relate. It's only worse now, you know. So that's Ty Bizarro. Check out his channel. Support him and his other friend, the other high guy. Don't remember your name. And I don't know what happened, but we don't care. It's just like with everything else, something happened. Oh, well, move on. If you share, that's fine. If not, we're not here to pry. Why do I need to know that, you know? Let's see, I'm looking through some of these other things that I subscribe to. I subscribe to a lot of conservative people, you know. So, you know, I subscribe to Jace Townsend and Sons Incorporated, which is all about historical reenactment, which I think looks like a whole lot of fun to do. If you had a lot of time in your hands and money, boy, wouldn't that be fun. Let's see what else. So I have varied taste. You don't just have to check out marijuana channels. Damon Drop, Wilderness Outfitters, The Dab Demon, you know, Cutlery Lover. He's a classic amongst the gun guys and knife enthusiasts. You know, I'm not against guns and knives. I'm against you collecting them like ladies collect cats. Okay? Starts to say something. One wasn't enough. You know. You have to own everything. Why? Now I have to start questioning why. Urban Remo out of Canada. A lot of advertisements for his products, but he's great. And he has a lot of access to a lot of events, so you can see things that are going on in Canada. It's really cool. Trailer Park Boys, because now they have a YouTube channel and they're pumping out some of their past videos from their Swearnet channel, which I still very much enjoy. Stoned Reviews, I love them. They're so cute. Fender Guitar Company, because I want to know about Fender guitars. And like I said, Sugar Mary. If you don't check out any other videos that I've asked you to check out Sugar Mary. He has not one fucking thing to do with weed. He's just a nice guy. I wish I could be his friend. He's just a guy that, I mean, is he always this cheerful or is he just, he seems like the nicest dude and you could not be around him without being happy. and he's an entertainer and juggler and stuff, but he does these hiking videos, and he's got a new one called Foothill Trails Thru-Hike with the Hickory Brothers, part one. And I'm just a huge fan. I'm a huge fan of his channel. I'm a huge fan of his vibe, and I like going there because it's like, it's meditative. It makes me feel good. It makes me feel good. I like knowing he's there. It makes me feel good about the world, you know? Okay, so I'm going to leave you with two videos. And the last one I will leave you with is a link to Sug Mary's Foothill Trail Hike Through, right? And this other one we mentioned earlier. All right, so I'll see you on Monday. You stay high and goodbye. And I'm getting pretty good medicated. Now it's time to go and be a real person and pick up all the Coke cans and stuff I left around my computer playing games and goofing off yesterday. I'm shopping for guitar parts. I'm looking for wired pickup guards. So I'm just sitting here drinking Coke cans and eating chips and just looking through millions of images because I'm a researcher type person and I'm learning. It's like, you know, like when you first learn a skateboard, you buy the shit skateboard and then you start learning what the good parts are and then you start shopping for as close as you can come to the good parts. So I'm just like, yeah, until midnight and researching marijuana in between. But I'm just like, oh, shopping right now. So I'll see you on Monday. You stay high and goodbye and take it easy.